Hello everyone, welcome back to our welcome to the Geeky Twins and back to our playthrough of Stories of the Path of Destinies. It's a PS4 game where there is 24 different paths to play, thus giving you 24 different endings, 25 with the true ending. And I've went ahead, pretty much finished the game. Like, I've got the true ending, which you can see in our other playthrough. And if you're just now tuning in with us, I would suggest that you watch the intro video and read the description there. Now we're on to number 16. And let's go ahead and start.
The clouds parted over the Isles of Boreas. It was time to choose. The rebellion was in trouble. Ravens were scouting for the secret rebel base. They needed a game changer.
Pieces of the Sky Ripper had surfaced. Renata knew that using it could go catastrophically wrong, but he was sure he could figure out how to use it safely. Also, a temple had risen out of empty desert. The Iblis Stone was hidden there. It was a dangerous artifact. It could corrupt its user into a bloodthirsty monster. Maybe he could find a way to use it, to take its power without surrendering to its wickedness. And also, his old friend Lupino needed rescuing. Of course, Renato had a pretty strong suspicion that Lupino had betrayed the rebellion, and he had a gut feeling that he needed to use that to his advantage. The island was windswept desert. No one went there except ostriches and ostrich hunters. The Iblis Stone. It would whisper promises in his ear, offer him power for blood. But this time, Renato was sure he could master it. And so, Renato went ostrich hunting. Every child could sing verses about the Sky Ripper, but ancient codices held hints of other things. A stone that ate souls, a ruby that drank blood, a jewel only a righteous man could give away. Were all these things the Iblis Stone? Long hidden in a buried temple, another ancient item that was only resurfacing now, drawn up from the deeps by the Emperor's horrific rituals. Frustration. They were still searching for a way in. Good. Then he hadn't come too late. Renato was remembering all his old tricks, and some new ones. Now, he really ought to ask for a raise. There had to be some way to use the Iblis Stone. It was old, wasn't it? People are so much cleverer now. And Renato was pretty sure he was cleverer than most people. The ravens at least could not get past this point. Obviously, the temple builders knew how to deal with tomb raiders. Ronaldo could feel his fur singe. It was a stone of the purest blackness. It reflected no light, like a void made solid. Nervous, he picked it up. Who said that? It was the stone. Eager. Thirsty.
Give the Emperor's daughter. Now you, Emperor.
That seemed tempting and terribly wrong. Zenobia was the Emperor's greatest general and a potent witch. But they had been close once.
And he had a sneaking suspicion the gem would try to control him.
Why not capture the core of Sky Ripper instead? It was the eye of a lost god torn out by the transcendent Emperor to power his greatest weapon.
What's the core?
Said the stone anxiously.
What you want?
But even though Ronaldo knew how evil the gem was, he had a clever plan for dealing with it.
I'm gonna go ahead and try this one. For number 16, it says to do this. But then I think this is one that you die.
The gem could give great power, but it was evil. But Ronaldo had a plan. He would divide the stone into the power half and the evil half. He sought out the sage Calaveras.
Oh, you need a mirror of splitting,
croaked Calaveras.
I can make one.
Calaveras set up various shiny things. And soon Ronaldo was setting the stone down in the middle of Calaveras' lab. There was a flash, and now Ronaldo was looking at himself. Except with a mustache, and a goatee, and darker hair. There were two Iblis stones. One light, and one dark. Ronaldo took the light one. He felt a rush of great power. Now I can defeat the Emperor. Wait a minute. Unfortunately, he couldn't think of any way to use it without hurting someone. That wouldn't be nice.
Give me that,
said his evil-looking twin. And he drew his sword. He only got it halfway out of the scabbard when he fainted from the effort. Obviously, neither weak, evil Ronaldo nor powerful, nice Ronaldo was any threat to the Empire. After the Emperor's victory, they were exhibited in a museum until time ended, which was soon after. He had tried something bold and paid the price for it. The stone bothered him. He hated being told what to do. Wasn't that why he'd joined the rebellion? Wasn't that why he'd refused to be a soldier? He'd agreed to come on board only if he could freelance. The stone felt a bit clingy, and he had a feeling it did not have his best interests at heart. The sage Calaveras had told him where to find the Sky Ripper, a weapon capable of challenging the gods. Even without its armature, the core would still possess great power. He would go there. The moment he landed the Farfarer, Ronaldo had a rare feeling of regret. It's not too late, he thought. He could turn around and sail for Zenobia's island. He frowned. Wait a minute. He didn't want to kill Zenobia, did he? Sure, technically she was the enemy, but they'd been at Sword Food School together. They'd never been lovers, but somehow they'd been closer. She'd told him every secret about herself. Except the biggest one. That she was the Emperor's daughter.
No. Kill Sylvia.
Whispered the stone.
Before it's too late.
The waterfall was spectacular. You had to enjoy these things as they came. We pass this way but once. There was something sour in the air. Like the earth had ruptured over something that had been fermenting for a very long time. The stone hadn't lied about what it could do for him. With each raven he cut down, he felt a jolt of power flowing into his arm.
"You're weak,"
whispered the stone. "Are you afraid of it?"
"No, don't be ridiculous,"
it chuckled.
But it's unstable. It'll poison you if someone just carried it. And if you try to use it, it will explode catastrophically."
Renardo did not trust rocks that talked in his head. He went onwards. Renardo suddenly wished he had a marshmallow. As he approached the core, the stone became hysterical.
"No! It's too much power! We'll rip a hole in space and time!"
He had a sudden vision of plunging his gauntlet into the core and dying in anguish. That wasn't his vision, was it? The stone had sent him its darkest fears, hadn't it? He had a sudden impulse to do exactly that. He raised his right fist and plunged it into the core. There was a rush of light. He thought he could hear the stone screaming. And then he passed out. When Renardo came to, the core was gone. But the Ibla stone was no longer black, but glowing with a blue light. And it was silent. "I can't hear you," he sang out. And, "Yoo-hoo!" It didn't answer. "Ha," he said. He had defeated the demonic gem with the power of his mind. He felt invincible. It was time to... But among the huge crystals, there was also an observatory. A wise man would probably ask the scientists exactly what he had first. How wise was he? As the Farfarer sailed towards the Nexus, Renardo wondered if the core had been created to silence the stone, or even to feed its hunger. Honestly, he didn't care. He felt terrific, and he appreciated the quiet inside his head. The Nexus was infested with ravens. But that didn't bother Renardo. With each death, the converted Ibla stone in his gauntlets glowed brighter, and he felt stronger. Wow. He was getting a bit bloodthirsty, wasn't he? Well, he wasn't worse. He was a warrior. They're supposed to be bloodthirsty.
What is it?
Hey, here you go.
What is it? Hello? I'm put it on streaming. Speaker, Jesus. Hello?
Are you streaming?
Yes.
Alright. Just checking.
Why?
Alright, I'm watching, so you know you have 4 viewers.
Yeah, every time I play this I usually end up at least with 3. Okay, I'm only doing this one path, and then we're going on an errand. But I want to try and get this game done by this weekend. So
absorbed in the stone was doing its job perfectly. Renata could
feel
a little eldritch jolt every time he downed a raven, but then it flowed into the glowing stone the way water flows down a riverbend. It all felt perfectly natural, as if all his life, this was what he had been meant to do. With the core absorbed in the stone, Renato had enough power to challenge the Imperial fleet. First, he would disrupt the enemy communication lines. Then he would head for the rebel base. From there, the rebellion would launch its final attack. Renato tore through the last remaining guards at the outpost like hot coffee through snow. There was a fire speaker toad here. He called the council speaker. He knew she would be thrilled. And she was. She wanted him to come back to base. They had plans to discuss and a medal to give him. A large golden medal. Great, said Renato. Let's talk about who else I can kill. Then the fire speaker croaked again.
Hello, Renato,
it said.
If you get sick of slaughtering second-rate birds in the Nexus, I am waiting for you in the mountains.
Zenobia. She missed him. She loved him. Once she saw how awesome he'd become, maybe she'd join him. They'd kiss and... Well, if she did refuse for some reason, he was no match for him now.
This is a different kind of music.
Zenobia was taunting him. No doubt she hoped to lure him into a trap, but it didn't matter, did it? He could fight his way out of any trap. He was invincible. This was gonna be fun. So where was this ambush? Renato couldn't wait. At Swordfu School, she'd always studied a little harder, practiced a little longer, complained. Really a lot less. And then she'd become a sorceress. He'd always known he'd have to take her by surprise or not at all. But this would be a surprise indeed.
The mountain paths were infested with ravens. That was swell. Every time he cut one down, the stone glowed a little brighter. In fact, everything glowed a little brighter. Look how white the snow was. They're very blue the raven blood was. Seriously, where was she? He wanted to try his new strength against hers. Renata felt antsy. He found a source of great power. But instead of joining with the rebels, he was on a fool's errand the Emperor's daughter had sent him on. The rebels were preparing a last-ditch attack against the Imperial fleet. Counting on Renata... At the end of the path was Zenobia. "I thought you were going to ambush me," he said, a little put out. "I owe you better than that. I know how you feel about me, love. You want to join up with me, don't you? You got to admit, we'd make a great team." Of all the arrogant, ham-handed, half-assed, half-witted... Oh, come on. What else are you here for? "That," she said, as a dropship poured a bucket of green liquid on his head. "Drowsy gas. You can't stop me with drowsy gas, Zenobia. My power's too strong. Zenobia? Where was she?" When he awoke, he was staring up at the sky. Zenobia looked down at him, frowning. "I probably ought to kill you, but that'd be a bit tawdry, wouldn't it?" She was tossing the glowing stone from paw to paw. "This is pretty."
"Zenobia!"
he shouted, and then he fell back into sleep. On the Farfarer, Renato drank his favorite headache remedy. But it did no good. Zenobia had beaten him again. Oh, he really should have listened to the Ibla Stone in the first place instead of messing around with the core. He had a bad feeling about the upcoming fight, but what kind of hero misses the final battle? Renato was bruised and tired. He wasn't looking forward to killing ravens. It didn't even seem scary. It felt like a chore, like sweeping the practice room at Swordfu School, which he'd done his best to leave for Zenobia whenever he could. What would she do with the glowing Ibla Stone? That should terrify him, shouldn't it? But he just felt dull and stupid as he carved his way towards probable doom. "Clean up around here," he thought. all so unfair. He'd wanted to protect himself, protect the world from the Ignistone's hunger for blood and souls. And all he'd done is get mugged. Next time he owned a supernatural artifact that wanted tribute, he'd serve it champagne and caviar. Zenobia was cleaning blood off her sword and weeping.
It's so hungry. I can't stop killing, she said.
But I fed it the core of the Sky Ripper.
And now it's hungry again, she wept. It was true.
The Iblisstone was black again, a void that seemed to suck all the light out of the sky.
Take it from me, Renardo, while you still can.
Okay. I'll take it, he said. Yes, he thought. This is what it means to be a hero. To save the soul of even his old enemy when it looked like all was lost. He stepped forward to accept the sword from her outstretched hand. She flipped the sword, and the blade went into his gut. As the Iblisstone sucked his soul into its infinite darkness, he could vaguely hear a voice, something like Zenobia's chuckle. Sucker.
Story number 16, The Fox Who Got Mugged. And then this also had the secret... believe it or not, this one also had the secret twin path where he stepped into a mirror and he was a good fox and a bad fox. But there was no proper ending to it. But this one had it as well if you want to look through it. I was a hero who fights until the end, even when he is humiliated. I got 5 win essence, which doesn't matter anymore. I found the gem, found the core, attacked the outpost, and met Zenobia. The Iblisstone, it whispers and it corrupts. On a hunch, Renardo fed it the Sky Ripper's core. It silenced the stone. Perfect. Now he could win the war for the rebellion. Victory after victory, Renardo's confidence grew while the Imperials shook in their boots. When Zenobia, the Emperor's greatest general, sent him an obvious invitation into a trap, he eagerly accepted. Okay, I can't go down. To scroll. Can I not? Okay, there we go. Still not. Okay. Overconfidence led to his downfall. When he met her, he lost both the Iblisstone and his pride. But he fought on. Little did he know that the core had weakened and the gem was freed to corrupt. When he met Zenobia again, it was too late. He did not stand a chance. So there you go. There is number 16, The Fox Who Got Mugged. And also, it had the secret path in there, too, which I'll have to put in the title of the YouTube video. Okay, so there you go. And in the next one, we will continue on to story 17. Thank you all for watching.